Professor Thurner works at the Medical University of Vienna, and he also founded the research group there on complex systems. He is also a visiting professor at the Santa Fe Institute. Professor Thurner has a PhD in physics, but later he switched more to biological problems and problems in complex systems. And when I first learned about his works and his transition, it actually motivated me to be more brave with trying problems in other disciplines, and I'm thankful for it. Professor Thurner is widely known and has a long list of publications, affiliations, and awards in academia. But few people know that he is also known outside academia for as a musician. And in 1993, he founded a chamber orchestra. Well, we are pleased to have him as a guest here at NTU, and he presented his works on study on behavior and management of systemic risk, and today he will be talking about how complexity breaks causality. So help me to welcome Professor Thurner.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much, Paralimis and Jan, for the invitation. I would like to do a couple of things. First, I would like to make a couple of statements. First statement is, because I've heard the opposite yesterday, yes, I believe that we will come up eventually with a unified framework for complex systems. Complexity is not too complex that we will never be able to do that. It's part one of my credo. Second part of my credo is, I believe that we will sooner or later understand complex systems. And third, in a way that we can manage them. And I would like to show you one example today where we really can manage a complex system. In what sense? How do I prove to you that I can now manage something that we would say, no, you cannot manage such a thing? How do you prove that the devil exists? Well, you have to go down to hell and cut off the tail of the devil, and then you have to demonstrate it. And this is what I'm going to do. I will show you that I can cut off the tails of complex systems. I can take a power law, cut it off, I can manage the power laws of complex systems. We'll do this in the context of systemic risk of financial markets. Reason for this is because the data there is fantastic. The way we're going to manage this systemic risk is done maybe not in the most elegant way. It's done by controlling every single element of the complex system. But, okay, we're living in the big data world. What's the problem? We have the capacity of doing so. I'll try to convince you that this is the case. Managing complex systems becomes possible if we control for every single detail of the thing. If we are missing a detail, we might run into the catastrophe of not being able to manage it, and the tail is back at the devil. And now the big problem arises. How should I do that in a way that's compatible with the task Jan gave us? How can I make this look like a natural consequence of making some more or less reasonable remarks about reality, causality, and complexity? That I will fail in this part, you have already seen in the title. This is not a good title, and it does not at all capture what I'm going to talk about. Okay, but I will stick to the task. I'll make an idiot out of myself with the first couple of slides. So what is reality? We, of course, don't know. It's a huge source of confusion. Maybe what we could keep in mind for the next couple of slides, I'll come back to it, The states a system can take has something to do with reality, and the states a system might take, can take, might have to do something with reality. It's much easier to talk about causality, I guess, especially if we choose physics as a way of reasoning about reality. Physics is one way of saying, making statements about reality. And physics has a lot to do with causality. And in particular, it has to do with making predictions. If we can predict something, well, the system is maybe pretty causal. And I fear that one should, in order to make intelligent statements, one should distinguish between determinism, causality, and predictability. But of course, I cannot make it. I'll use it all up in the same way. What prediction means is not a static thing. The concept of what prediction means in physics has changed dramatically over the past 300 years. In Newton's times, a prediction meant computing an exact trajectory, knowing something exactly. You understand the system by putting down a differential equation, and then by fixing a boundary condition, you solve for this equation, and you have an exact prediction of what your system is. Around 1900, this was challenged by the problem that we were starting to handle many, many particles at the same time. And predictions of many particles, or any number of particles more than three, becomes extremely hard. But if you relax the concept of predictability a little bit, it became possible in the context of statistical mechanics to do fantastic predictions again for billions of billions of billions of billions, I think now I'm about to stop, of particles. Yeah, 10 to the 23 particles, we can make fantastic predictions. These are not exact predictions anymore, but we are predicting the collective of all the gas atoms in this room fantastically if we change the volume of this room, which we hopefully don't do. In the 1920s, then, the next crisis in physics and next crisis of determinism is about to appear. Our components are not deterministic any longer. Whether they exist or are decayed, we cannot say with certainty anymore. In statistical mechanics, we had atoms or ideal gas atoms. These are things that always exist. Quantum mechanics, an atom may decay, or it may be here, or it may be here, or it might be here and there at the same time, certain extent. So our components of the system, of systems, become unpredictable, fundamentally unpredictable, but still, we have to relax our sense of predictability a little bit, but still we are perfectly able of making predictions about collections of these of atoms, molecules, and yeah. In fact, we can compute everything. We can predict all, practically all, features of matter that we are confronted with. And a little bit later, from the 1990s on, what is happening is that we are relaxing the concept of interactions, which were very strict in physics. There's only four types of interactions. We are now relaxing the concept, or expanding the concept of interactions, to many, many more than four types of interactions. And these interactions are not homogeneous in space anymore, and they are not the same at every point in time anymore, but they are time-dependent interactions. And if you have time-dependent interactions and time-dependent components, you have elements of complex systems. And still, we must believe that sooner or later we can make fantastic predictions about complex systems. We're not there yet, but almost. So the fantastic thing is, even if we relax determinism, collectives of things remain predictable. So, we're living in a big data age. Can we predict better with computer power? What is big data age? When is big data big? We need a reference scheme. I would say we can discuss if that's a good idea or not. Data is big if it's big compared to the processing power you have to process it. So if the data you have divided by the computing power that you have is larger than one, you have big data. How much data is there in the world? So in a study in 2011, you find that there were certain amount of exabytes. I don't know how much that is. No matter how much that is, if you look at the annual growth rate of data on the planet, it's about 23% annually. It's a fantastic exponential growth with the growth rate of 20%. So one unit in the 80s becomes 60 units 20 years later. How much computing power is there in the world? So in 2000, there was, if you put all computers together, there was more or less the computing power of one human brain. I don't know how they really come up with these statements, but that's what you can read. But no matter how much computing power there is, what's worthwhile, or how much computing power there was, what's worthwhile to note is that the annual growth rate of increase of computing power is about 60%. This is uncomprehensible. So one unit in the 80s becomes 10,000 units 20 years later. So no matter where we start initially, computing power will win immensely. So we are in the opposite of a big data era. Yeah, our computing power is so good. So why are we not much, why didn't we get much further? We cannot predict, we cannot treat the flu really, we cannot predict crashes, we cannot predict social unrest, we cannot predict weather, we cannot compute in a convincing way that we would convince American presidents that climate change is happening. And we cannot predict what the world population in 20 years is going to be. So the error bars are mind-blowing. So this is because these are complex systems. Complexity is increasing much, 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 much more than our computing power. That's a statement. What is complexity? Complexity, in a nutshell, is that the number of combinations of data that you can put together, that you want to put together to understand things is exploding at even greater rates than I've shown you. Yeah, okay. The limiting factor is neither data. We are recording about everything now. Whether we have access to it or not is a different question. It's not the computing power, generally. It's our understanding of what complex systems are and where we have to understand them. Good. First part of my task from Jan. What are complex systems? I think complex systems are, I'm using this slide all the time, are co-evolving multiplex networks. That's all a complex system is. What is a co-evolving multiplex network? It looks like a network, but it's not a network. It's a very dynamic thing. So here, you know, there's different nodes. Nodes have different states, different colors, different shapes, etc. They can change over time. And you see that there's interactions or relations between these nodes, and these are of different type. So if these, if the nodes are people, this could be social, different social relations like friendships or enemies or communication or whatever. And these interactions are also something that's dynamic. It's not static. And a complex system is a system where the changes of the states of your nodes depend on what? On the interactions between those nodes. So whether this thing will turn red in the next time step depends how it is embedded in the system. There's no other interactions influencing that thing except the influence from the rest of the world. And all of the world is in this graph. You just have to keep multiplying and adding layers to this until you're satisfied with your world. But there's, yeah. And at the same time, depending on what the states of these nodes are, your interactions, your links are changing over time. Okay? Now you have something that's a chicken-egg problem. Your states change as a function of the topology changes as a function of the states. It's a chicken-egg problem. This looks like something like this. I'm saying the same thing again. So here I should say these nodes we represent by states, and these states we call sigma. Sigma I labels which node we are talking about. And the different layers in this network, we denote by M. M for matrix. M connects I and J and is of type alpha. The changes of states is a function. We don't know what that function is generally, but it's a function that depends on the interactions and on the states of the system. This is what physics is. Yeah? You fix your interactions, your force. F is, for example, Newton's law or any stochastic law, and you have to fix a boundary condition or initial condition. Then you can compute this, and you make a prediction, and you test it. If it's bad, F is wrong. If you couple this second line, you get a complex system. And the second line is how do your interactions, how does your force change as you develop your system over time? This is hard to digest to physicists because this gets us out of physics. You cannot solve these kind of chicken-egg coupled problems. Why? Because we cannot fix any boundary condition there. Our boundary conditions, Stuart talked about boundary conditions, are co-evolving with the system. How these interactions evolve is given by another function that depends on the same, on the interactions and the states of the system. Okay? This is, I think, a general framework of a complex system. I think it's a general framework for basically everything. I would love to get an email one day and saying, I have a system that's out of this, of this class. F can be whatever. Can be stochastic, can be deterministic, can be linear, can be nonlinear, whatever you want. First part is physics. If you couple this with a change of interactions as the dynamics goes along, you have a complex system. The closest physics gets to this is what? Does someone want to take a guess? Huh? No? General relativity. For dynamics to happen, you need a space. As the dynamics happens, you're changing your space and your forces as something is going on. So maybe one of the more complicated things in physics is this, one of the simplest complex systems. Okay, now let me just make a couple of more statements about this. Why this is important, if you claimed a couple of years ago that this was a sensible concept, they would say, no, you're crazy. This is way too general. This does not make sense. Why does it make sense? We can observe. We might not be able to solve these equations if someone told us what F and G was, or if we find out what it is. But we can look at every single component of this. We can look at the networks as they exist, as the interactions, who interacts with whom. We can look at the states. Are we green? Are we blue? Are we rich? Are we poor? And we can look at the changes of the interactions. Did I like this person yesterday? Now I like him. Okay, there was an event that changed this. And did I change my state from poor to rich? You can observe all of this. And NSA is doing it for you. And yeah, and every all modern companies are doing this for us, if we like it or not. So this is what I mean. A complex system framework could be that it's co-evolving multiplex networks. What's co-evolving? States and networks are co-evolving. Dynamics and constraints are co-evolving. Note that there's everything there. Also, you often say, when you talk about complex systems, the context is important. So where's the context here? So in the context, if we focus on one type of interaction, just let's explain the friendship of people. How does that work? Then we focus just on the dotted line. What's the context of it? It's all the other interactions. So the context is there. It's really, the whole thing is sitting there. Yeah. This kind of dynamics is path dependent, it's history dependent, it's possibly open-ended. If you make these things infinitely large, it can become open-ended. So I think it's really a good context. And we will, in our example, just use an example of this, where the nodes are banks, Mexican banks. The states of these banks are just how rich are they, how much capital buffer do they have, and the interaction will be, does bank A have a loan at bank B? This is one type of interaction. Or does this bank have a credit default swap issued against that bank? Does it have a derivative on someone else? It's another type of interaction. Or does it have, did it issue another bet, an option, or a future, or whatever, on another player? So this will be our example. Complex systems are intrinsically unstable. We know that by saying power laws are associated with complex systems. That's what we're saying, they are unstable. Why? Because large outliers are the norm. Fat tails, power laws, is nothing else but the fact that outliers are the normal situation. So, and if you have lots of outliers, the thing is unstable. Okay. Yeah, and this is the point I already said, and I will say it one more time when we come to the example. If I know and understand everything, every single detail in the system, every link, every state in that thing, I may break complexity by controlling every component. And we'll see how that works. Okay. Good. Now to the example. Jan, how did I do in my job? Yeah, with the reality and causality, that was this part. Systemic risk is the risk that the system collapses, that we are that we are experiencing a large outlier, an extreme event, which are maybe not so infrequent. Systemic risk to this point is not very much understood. If it was understood, why we would not be afraid of financial crisis anymore, we would not be afraid of revolutions, etc. So there's three types of financial risk. Let's just disentangle it for a second. There's economic risk. This is the risk that if I make an invention, I produce a prototype, it fails. And I lose my investment in my invention, in the cost of the prototype, it fails. The business idea was bad, no one bought it. This is economic risk. Who is taking that risk? Typically, for your first invention, your grandmother takes that risk. She gives you the first 10,000. Later on, the financial system takes that risk. Yeah, you want to create a company, you go to the stock market, people give you the money, believing that it will fly. It might not fly, then all the people who bought stocks in your company, they are now paying off the risk, the economic risk that you introduced by your new idea. Credit default risk is what the bankers are talking about all the time. If I give you something, credit default risk is the risk that you don't give it back to me. So, and we are regulating this kind of risk with banking regulation. You might have heard this famous banking regulation discussions that are going on since decades. And the name for the banking regulation that's working in the Western world is called the so-called Basel regime, Basel II regime. And we're now introducing Basel III. Systemic risk is something very different from those two. Systemic risk is the risk that a significant fraction of the whole system stands still, stops, does not work, does not perform its function. Yeah. In the financial system, what does it mean? I default, I cannot pay back my loans to you, so you might default. And what does default mean? It means that the judge comes and says, your business is closed, no money in, no money out. You wait until this is resolved. Then it takes a couple of years until we can start paying back or receiving outstanding things. So it's just blocked, paralyzed in time. I said this. Why are we not? So this is the risk that we should be afraid of most. This is the risk we are, when we're talking about financial crisis, we are talking about this risk. This is the thing that makes the fear. But we are not regulating it. Banks are not trying to reduce this kind of risk. Why? Because they cannot. You have to know every detail of the system to know, to quantify what systemic risk is. So it must be the role of the regulator, of our government, of our central banks, of our maybe green parties, to manage this kind of systemic risk. There's two ways we can get systemic risk. One way is a synchronization effect. Everyone starts doing the same thing out of a sudden. We're all buying or selling the same things at the same time, then the markets can boom or crash. It's not what I would like to talk about. We're talking about networks of contracts. The financial system is nothing else but a time-evolving, co-constructing network of contracts. What is co-constructing? The wealth of the banks is co-constructing the the financial, the networks of financial assets. If a bank is not very rich, it cannot borrow a lot. So the state determines what kind of interactions, what kind of assets you can buy or hold or issue or whatever. And the assets that you hold determine the wealth of you at the next time step. Yeah. So this is the Austrian banking network at one particular point in time. Every dot is a bank. Every link is a credit from one bank to another. Links, are, of course, have different width. But you see, this is nothing very, very tremendously big or anything. It's just a nice little network. Systemic risk happens on multiple layers. This is, again, important to say. So one layer can be in the financial system, can be the lending borrowing network, the credit network. One can be the derivative network. One can be the liquidity network. One can be the foreign exchange network. Whatever you can trade gives a layer. These are five actual layers of the Mexican banking network at one particular day in 2013. Just to show you that five networks. How do we now quantify systemic risk? What we would like to have is a number, ideally for every bank. How much damage do you do if the system collapses? You as a bank, you as a player in the financial network. So the input that we have to give to the system, the input that we need for the computation, is the network of financial relations, and then we try to compute such a number. The cool thing is that Google had the same problem some time ago when it wanted to rank the importance of pages. It came up with an algorithm that that ranked or gave numbers to pages, numbers, and these numbers corresponded to importance of pages. When is a page in Google important? Is a Google page, every dot is a Google page. A page is important. The fatter it is, the more important it is. And it's more important if other important pages point to it. I'm important if many important people point to me. Or if many, many, many unimportant people point to me, then I'm also important. But I can be important if just a few people are very important and point to me, then I'm also important. So this guy is important because many not so important people point to him. And this guy is important because three important people point to him. This is at the essence of the so-called page rank algorithm, which used to be the miracle behind Google. So a page is important if many important pages point to it. Now let's do the same reasoning for systemic risk. When is an institution systemically risky? If systemically risky institutions lend to it. We would have to go to an argument why it's lending and not borrowing. You might think it should be borrowing, but that's the correct thing. If we keep exactly this reasoning, we can compute a value for systemic risk almost as easily as Google can compute the importance of a web page. And it's a triviality, a computational triviality. Just that Google is confronted with billions of pages, and we are confronted with 10,000, 20,000 banks. It's a triviality. You can compute it on your cell phone if you want. I'm not going to go into the details of how to compute this systemic risk factor which is called debt rank, and we keep R, let's keep R in mind for debt rank, the risk that's associated with an individual bank. So I'll skip over this. So the input that we need for this computation is a network. The output is every bank gets a number, R sub I, and this number is the percentage of the total damage that bank was responsible for. So if we have a massive collapse, the damage is 10 billion euros, and if a bank had an R of 0.5, this bank is responsible for 5 billion of damage. So very clear thing. This is now a simple example. We take the Austrian banking network and just pick out two relatively important banks. They have lots of credits from other banks. In the next slide, this bank, this little bank, will take a credit from this one. I'll show you. Now I have to tell you what the colors mean. If the color is green, there's no systemic risk. If you kick out that bank, nothing happens. If it's red, then it's a little bit risky, and there will be some damage. And if it's red, then it's pretty dangerous. And if it's very red, it's very dangerous. So by adding one link between these two banks, one little detail, we're changing the world completely. This guy becomes the most relevant, the most risky point in the system. It's not the largest bank. The size of these things is how large, how much capital do they have. And it becomes the most dangerous bank. Okay? This is the whole thing at one point in time. If we take this value now, bank by bank, we can plot a profile. And let's put to the left the most risky bank. And here we put maybe the 20th risky bank. And here we put this R factor. So we see if we kill the right bank in Austria, we can stop 80% of all the financial flows. The terrorists know who, should not give you the hint. So this is a systemic risk profile for a country. You can do that for every country that has these networks available. This is Mexico. In Mexico, if you kill the most systemically relevant bank, it's only 35% that stop, 35% of the financial economy that stop as a consequence. So it's much, much safer. The risk profile, systemic risk profile, is much better in Mexico. Why? Because the network is different. The underlying networks are very different in the different economies. Okay, if we know this, we can do a little bit of intellectual playing and thinking, and we can come up with a number, the expected systemic loss. This is a number in euros per year. That is the expected loss due to a systemic event. So if something happens, how big is the total loss going to be? And it's surprisingly simple. It's a default probability of individual banks. How you get this is a different question. It's something that central banks do for a living to find how dangerous are their banks in their system, times this debt rank, this R that I've shown you. This is looks extremely simple. It's the way to get there is not simple at all. It involves lots of combinatorics, but this whole horrible sum of products turns out to be one, so we get this extremely simple result. It's fantastic. And here's the result. Look at the gray, the light gray line. This is what this expected systemic loss is for Mexico computed at every day. So we can compute this at every day. This is before the crisis. This is up to 2014, or almost 2014. You see this is exploding, and then it's leveling off here. If you compare it to where it started, the total expected systemic loss is about 4 to 5 times bigger than before the crisis. Meaning if something happens now, it's going to be 4 to 5 times more costly for the taxpayer to get the system started again or going again. So for Mexico, that might not be a big deal. But for Greece, if you tell a Greek person that the next, we don't know this curve for Greece. We only know it for a few countries. Greece is not among them. But if that curve was for Greece, and if you tell a Greek taxpayer, if they exist, that was completely inappropriate. That the next crisis would be 4 times more expensive, then you would maybe get kicked out wherever you are. Okay. The other curves here is market-based systemic risk indicators that I sometimes use. And you see that they all go back to previous levels. So if you look at market indicators, they don't capture the true systemic risk that's there. Why? Because the markets don't see the networks very easily. Okay, so I think I said it. We made one observation on which we are extremely proud. Namely, that we can not only look at systemic risk for every bank, but we can make a statement about the systemic risk of every single transaction. Every transaction changes the total systemic risk in the system. And this opens a a world. So for Austria, this is for 1 month is all the credits between all the banks. Here's the size of this credit. And here is the systemic risk increase this special credit puts to the system. The marginal systemic risk or the systemic risk increase of that particular transaction. What you should notice here is that we plotted this in double logarithmic scale. So if you take this transaction here, this is a credit of, I don't know, it's not euros here. Let's say that this on this line is all the credits of the size of 1 million euro. I can get on the market 1 million euro that has this systemic risk increase, but I also find the same thing, 1 million euro in credit, that has a factor of 10,000 more systemic risk. And that's a cool thing. If you find something where you have a difference of a factor not 3% or 3.5% or a p-value larger than or less than something, but a factor of 10,000, then you really have a major thing. This plot shows you how heavy systemic risk is. It's the same thing for Mexico, so not much of a difference. The different colors here is the different asset classes. We don't have to think about it. Here's the size of the transaction. Here's the systemic risk increase. Here's a diagonal, which you can maybe not see. It's plotted very softly. Everything that is above this diagonal, and almost everything is above this diagonal. I'm showing the diagonal again. Everything that's above the diagonal will lose more than it's worth. Okay? Why can we lose more than it's worth? Because we are damaging a network. We're having spillover effects. We're amplifying the risk. So everything that's above the diagonal is the systemic risk, the extra money you have to put down. The banks will lose whatever they have. But there will be more to pay. And this is what you will pay Everything that's above the diagonal is what the taxpayer will pay at the end. And you can convert this to euros, and you will see how immensely huge that is. So this is one, it's maybe the first plot where you can really see what systemic risk is, transaction by transaction. Every dot is a transaction, it's a couple of million dots here. So systemic risk is an externality for the economists. You are not paying as the creator of that risk for the consequences of that risk. You're creating it, but you're not paying for it. If you have an externality, then in a neoliberal world, then we may tax this. Okay? The only way to introduce a tax is if we can show that this is an externality. I have shown you on this plot that this is an externality. So let's manage this systemic risk by taxing transactions. If a transaction introduces lots of systemic risk into the system, the tax will be very high to make you not do that transaction. And if the transaction causes no additional systemic risk, it's tax-free. So, and by introducing such a tax, it's a smart tax, smart because it's different for every transaction, we will discourage people from doing these transactions here. We'll encourage people to do these transactions. That's all of the idea there is. So here my statement. Systemic risk management is the same thing as restructuring networks. If I'm putting a tax on a potential link, I, as the person who has to pay for that tax, will maybe not establish that link. I'll establish that link with someone else that's tax-free. And in that way, I have restructured my network. I've reconfigured it. If everyone is doing this, I'm restructuring my network. And how am I restructuring my network? I'm restructuring it in a way that if a default anywhere occurs, it cannot spread anymore. That's the idea. Okay, so I'm just repeating it again. So we know how systemic risk spreads through a network. I did not tell you in all detail how that's happening, but that's a standard textbook knowledge. We can measure for the first time how risky a transaction is in terms of how much does it increase the total systemic risk, and therefore we try to restrict these transactions and we tax those transactions. That's the idea. Okay, so ideally we don't want anyone to pay a tax. It's unrealistic in an Anglo-dominated world to talk about introducing taxes anywhere. The tax should just be there to not be paid. It's there to evade taxes. If everyone evades the tax, we restructure the network in a way we want it. And I'm going to show how that works out. One more important thing. If we are restructuring this network, what we want to make sure is that we are not taking out credit volume. We don't want to reduce the size of the system. No, we love our credit volumes. That we all lend our money to each other to realize ideas is fantastic. And that we are doing this at these huge rates as we are doing it right now is great. To a certain extent, if we would just not use it to destroy the planet. But in principle, this is a great thing, a sign of trust, if there's lots of credit in the system. And of course, if I take credit out of a system, I can make the system safe. If there's no credit allowed, the system is totally safe. Everyone can only lose as much as we possess. There's no systemic risk. But then there's also not much going on. I cannot buy a flat when I'm young. That's just not possible then. Okay. Maybe I don't go over it, but if you introduce such a tax, it's a self-stabilizing tax. It leads you to a self-organized critical system. And this might or now might not sound reasonable to you or not. Now we have to show that we're really reducing this systemic risk. How are we doing this? We are using one of the most sophisticated, if not the most sophisticated, agent-based model in the world to test this tax. This model consists of a banking sector, of households, of firms. Firms produce things, households buy these things, households work for the firms, households get payments and wages from the firms. Firms sometimes need loans to buy new machines or to pay for wages if they don't sell enough stuff. Then they take it from the financial sector. Where does the financial sector get the cash from? From households and from dividends that firms pay out to households and that households deposit there. It's so-called crisis model. It was about 20 programmers working for about 3 years to get that model together. It is a really sophisticated thing in the sense that you can test policies with that model. It's realistic enough to do policy analysis. I should say, from time to time, a firm is going bankrupt. Why? Because it's not selling enough stuff. And if the firm that goes bankrupt has an open loan at the bank, it cannot repay that loan anymore. The bank loses from its capital. If that's happening too often to a bank, if it has too many foul credits, the bank will get into trouble if it falls below a certain regulatory threshold. The capital falls below a regulatory threshold. The bank is not allowed to issue more credit. It has to de-leverage, and all of these things are happening in this game. If the losses are too big for banks, then banks go bankrupt. If they go bankrupt, this bankrupted bank might trigger a financial cascade that then leads to systemic risk. That is then a systemic event. So we implement this tax in the system, and for comparison, we implement also a Tobin tax. Tobin tax is around in the media. Tobin tax is not a smart tax, it's a stupid tax. It taxes every transaction, regardless of how risky it is. It was not stupid when it was introduced. Tobin was all but stupid. So let the computer simulate. Again, this was the systemic risk profile that we observed in Austria. If we take this agent-based model and make it look like Austria with the same, number of firms and the same working force and the same cost for labor, etc., then we get in the model result from a systemic risk profile, which is more or less the same as in reality. The red curve here is the systemic risk profile in the model. If we introduce the Tobin tax, that's the blue line, we are reducing systemic risk a little bit. We will see why. And if we implement the systemic risk tax, we are cutting systemic risk away almost. In this plot, this was the situation for the different loans and the systemic risk increase. Here's the situation in the model. We have no tax. We have red dots, which are spread around here, which is very, very similar to here. if we introduce the Tobin tax, it's the blue dots. Not much happens. It's a little bit reduced. But if we turn on the systemic risk tax, where people avoid risky transactions, we are shifting the systemic risk down to the diagonal. Yeah? And we're shifting it by at least an order of magnitude. Here I plot, and we do this 10,000 times. Here is the total losses, financial losses. In the red curves show you the famous fat tails of loss distributions. This is the fat tail of the devil, meaning that huge losses occur relatively frequently. If we turn on the Tobin tax, not much happens. And if we turn on systemic risk tax, we are cutting the tail. The tail is gone. What is this green thing remaining? This is the economic risk. The economic risk is the risk that I have a stupid idea to begin with. Okay? That my grandmother lost all her savings on me because she trusted in her grandson. So this is the proof that I can cut off the tail of the devil. So why is this working? Because we are rearranging the network in a way that cascading does not occur any longer. We are creating a new network. A new network is like a fabric. And you all know that there's different types of fabric. We used to smoke earlier in life. So, and many of you will have experienced if you burn a hole in an expensive shirt, you can wash it 15 times and it's always the same size. If you have a cheap shirt, by every time you wash it, the hole gets bigger. So we just reconfigured a network. We've made a new fabric out of it so that cascading is reduced. That's it. By controlling every single piece of the game. If we let some people not pay the tax, the thing is immediately not working any longer. So this is the cascade size. How many banks do default as a consequence of an initial default? And again, so it's a fat tail, huge cascades. And if we turn on the tax, cascading is much, much, much reduced. Here's the transaction volume. We have to make sure that the same volume is there after we introduce our smart control system. So the red thing is the original thing. This is the distribution of transaction volumes in the market. Nice Gaussian. If we turn on the systemic risk tags, it's exactly at the same position. Why? Because we are not forbidding any trade. We are just rearranging the links in the network. We're not reducing the density of the network. If we turn on the Tobin tax is very little tax, it has a huge effect on credit volume. Why? And this is the reason why no politician really wants to implement it, because this is a feared effect, and it's real in the sense of this agent-based model showing exactly what's expected. Shift of transaction volume in the credit market. We don't need an agent-based model to show it, but we needed 3 years to work on a mathematical proof. And that's the outcome of the proof. That we don't have to resort back to an agent-based model that you could always criticize for its high number of parameters, for its uncontrollability, for its unrealistic assumptions that at some point or another you will have. It's not necessary. There exists a systemic risk-free equilibrium under this systemic risk tax regime. There's many things that could go wrong. If this tax is not introduced in all countries at the same time, You can evade it through making transactions through that, through other countries. Maybe Basel III is taking care of this already. Basel III is, every time you open a newspaper and read about Basel III, you will read, it will take care of the systemic risk problem in the financial world. One of the promises of Basel III. So maybe we shouldn't care about such a systemic risk tax, and Basel III is doing it for some reason, right? And maybe the interbank credit network was not a relevant network. So far, I've only shown you one of these layers. So we can look at the different layers and compute the systemic risk of all three of them, and can decompose the total systemic risk in terms of different layers. This we can only do for Mexico because they have the best data. Austrian data does not work because we don't have that granular data. And we see that the credit network is marginal. Huge component of the risk in Mexico is the red component here, which is from which is foreign exchange swaps, basically. And the derivative risk in Mexico, that's the green thing, you can neglect completely. Does not play a role. So by zooming into the different layers, you can learn where you should regulate best most. And one thing is also important. If you add up all these individual layers, you do not reach the total systemic risk. The reason for this is that this systemic risk number that I showed you, debt rank, is a nonlinear, highly nonlinear function in the entries of the inputs. So total risk might be, if you are observing individually all layers, add it up, you are underestimating the total risk. Just a message. So this is a paper that came out last Friday, so it's a baby of 4 days. Here's the systemic risk profile. Red is, again, for doing nothing. Blue is turning Basel III regulation on. Nothing happens. Why does nothing happen? Because Basel III is not addressing the network question. Basel III, what it's doing is asking for increased capital requirements. They have to build up capital requirements for, depending on the assets they own, in a very sophisticated way. But the way it's done does not address systemic risk. So, super important message. We can implement it, but it will not work. If we put on the systemic risk tax, we have seen how much that reduces it. Okay. Basel III, if we implement it, changes a little bit the credit volume. Why? Because they have to do the capital requirements, and that this money is locked away from the markets, and it reduces the credit market. When does Basel III work? It starts working if you make the capital requirements three times as high as they are thinking about doing it now. Banks hate doing capital requirements. They don't like what is planned now in Basel III. And we are now telling them, if you want to have any effect on systemic risk, you must these requirements three times higher. Then you see something. So two is red, the red curve. Blue is nothing. No Basel in charge. No. Blue is implementing Basel III, which does nothing. If you take two times the capital requirements, you see a little bit of change. And if you take it three times, then you see an effect. That would be a nice effect. If you look at the transaction volume, this is extremely costly, of course. Yeah? You're destroying the banking system completely. If you're reducing the transaction volume by 20% or 30%, forget, this is not the banking, this is not the world we are living in now. Okay, I'm pretty much at the end. This is, to a large extent, work done by Sebastian. He's in charge of every piece of programming and a fantastic person to work with. I don't read the conclusions to you. I think it was pretty clear.
Thank you very much, Professor Thurner, for the wonderful talk. And okay, so the stage is now open for the questions. And okay, so the first one there, then Professor.
Thank you very much for the lecture. So I like to find out from you that does your model include intercurrency fluctuation? Because that, in the case of Mexico, for instance, that can have, in my imagination, have a pretty drastic effect. And so, as such, where does the intercurrency rates come in, and etc. I think you know where I'm getting at. Thank you.
Yes, of course. If you have foreign exchange swaps, then the actual currency fluctuations determine the value of your swaps. They change it every day. So every link that represents a foreign exchange swap changes its value at every day, according to these fluctuations, and you have to take this into account day by day and compute your effective exposures at that day and your systemic risk contribution in the foreign exchange layer will therefore also change day by day, even if you don't change the links. Just the link weights will change.
I think this is a beautiful piece of work, and I think you sent an earlier version to me 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah.
It's really beautiful. I particularly like it, incidentally, because there's lots of work on networks and lots of work on theoretical complexity, but it's quite rare that you see a very neat piece of work that's applied thinking. I've two questions for you. Maybe they're puzzles to me. Number one is that I think your assessment of systemic risk is basically recursive. You know, you're saying my risk depends on the risk I'm posing to others, which depends on the risk they're posing, which is really beautiful. And I think that would apply to epidemiology, that my risk as a person in spreading disease depends on the other people that I'm in contact with. If there's heterogeneity in the system, this would be very important in calculating R naught, or you know what I mean. I'm wondering what your comment is on that. And then secondly, this bit escaped me, but I think risks at in an economy are very highly correlated. So it's not just one bank that might start to transmit risks. But economically, there's ups and downs. Macroeconomically, a whole country can get into trouble all at once, so you might have hundreds of banks experiencing difficulties. Did you take such correlations into account? And probably not that hard to do if you want.
Brilliant question. I start with this, with the second one. No, I start with the first one. The situation is very much alike in epidemiologic situations. In fact, if you think of it, the SIR models, they are very much of this kind. No, they are co-constructing. The states are changing the infection probabilities, and the probabilities, infection probabilities, change the states or have an influence on your probability of getting infected. So I think this is very, very related. For the second question, I think you have exactly hit. When I showed you this, when you compute this total expected systemic loss, we have a default probability here, which should not be network dependent. And then here is all the network related part in. Can we get a network independent estimate of default probabilities from central banks today? It's very hard. When they are thinking about a default probability, they factor in, of course, a little bit of, they factor in their knowledge about the exposures to other banks, and if others go down, then they will go down, that increases their default risk. So in reality, we don't have a clear, it's very hard to get reasonable numbers for this. But we have to get those. And it's a challenge for taking new measurements as we understand where and what we need.
And they're correlated?
Huh? These two should not be correlated. In practice, when you go to a central bank and say, what's the probability that this bank defaults? Their estimate will involve or will contain their information about their network. It will be correlated. And you have to really ask and work with them to get estimates that take this out. Otherwise, you're counting twice. Same risk.
Hi.
Hi.
Just to do some type of cross-fertilization. I have experience in other big systems. First of all, we measure complexity by resorting to plecticity, concept. Plecticity, a concept introduced by Gell-Mann, the Nobel Prize that invented the quark. Secondly, we have shown for a national electric grid that the domino effect can be represented as a statistical phase transition. So you have the liquid phase and vaporous phenomenon, and also the tribal effect. And in lieu of the temperature and pressure, you have in the pressure the topology of the network, what you say. And to avoid domino effect, you have to change adaptively the topology, as you say, topology of the network. Another point that we have taken care of is the network controllable? Indeed, it is not always the case. And this is one point that I would like to put under attention. And the fourth point is who will be in charge of giving an accurate measurement of the risk, in this case of a bank, for our case, of other sources of domino effect. Thank you.
Okay. How would this work in practice? Who would give the task? The regulator. There is countries in the world who have this information, and if they have it, who has it? It's the central banks usually. The research departments of the central banks. And they would have to compute these numbers, which, as I mentioned, is a computational triviality. So how would it work? You want to buy something, or you want a credit, you send me, you go on your system, you ask me, what would a million cost? I give you a quote, 3%, and then the central bank sees that question and sends you a red number that is blinking on your screen and says, plus add 5% to that because it's super risky. Then you go to Jan and ask him for the $1,000,002. He tells you, no, he's not going to do it. Then you go to Steve. Doesn't matter. Anyone else who is less connected than I am in the network will give you this, maybe the same quote. It's a market after all. Get a similar quote, but a different number, maybe from the central bank. And then you take the best choice.
Excuse me if I insist. Do you really think that at the moment the economical situation of the world is controllable? Question mark.
I've shown you a story. If you understood it, I'm saying yes. If we want to control it,
it is not always so.
If we want to control this part of systemic risk that hit us the last time, we can control for this part. We can make it visible where the danger is, and we can single out the most risky parts of the system. We can draw a map of systemic risk in the world. This we can do if we want, if we put pressure on the governments, and maybe we are just one or two crises too far away from that point. But if we sooner or later want to manage systemic risk, we have to do it by controlling networks, exactly those networks. There is nothing else but those networks.
I think it's a good answer. And let's go to Professor Kaufmann.
Stefan, I'm kind of stunned at how brilliant all of that is. Now I want to ask a naive question. You have, you're trying to put a number on a bank called debt rank, which somehow tells you how you hope influences from failure of that bank or that node might propagate. I want to ask what justifies that. So let me give you another case. So we both know Boolean nets. So years ago, I invented Boolean nets. Here's the situation in Boolean nets. I've got a bunch of nodes, and they influence one another by some rules. Those networks can behave chaotically. In a chaotic regime, you know all this, but I'm just sort of sketching it for people. In an ordered regime where they could be critical. In the chaotic regime, if you twiggle one node, you get avalanches that propagate all over the place.
Yes.
In the ordered regime, most nodes are frozen, so if you toggle a node and change it, nothing much happens. Mm-hmm. And at the criticality, you get a power law distribution.
Yes.
This means that in that case, the way things propagate depends upon the dynamics of the network in addition to its connectivity. Okay?
Yes.
You haven't changed the connectivity, but you changed the dynamics. It would be very hard in that case to put a rank on a node. Mm-hmm. So
This is a good.
So how do you do it? Or with what justification?
If you were a physicist, then you're kind of.
Got to be an honorary physicist.
Honorary physicist. I'd say this measure is something like an eigenvalue.
Of the dynamics of the
of
system.
Of the dynamics of the system.
Okay.
It's more than.
So it's the leading eigenvalue. Something like that.
And if you ask yourself, in the example that you just gave, what is these three different regimes different, you could give an answer in terms of eigenvalue.
Yes.
One is larger than one. In one, you have typically one is larger than one. One is less
Good.
Than one. And the other one, I don't know.
Good. Thanks so much.
Andrew Chen, please.
Stefan, this is the greatest advance since Basel III. I'm a bank regulator, and I was stunned by how much you have achieved since using network theory on financial markets. And I congratulate you for that. And if this, what you presented, is a proof of why Basel III won't work, I'm 200-300% behind you, because that is the wrong way. Basel III is the wrong way of dealing with this, right? Because exactly as you say, they haven't handled the network problem. They're still using the deterministic view that if the bank is all right, the system is all right. The system is not all right. But I have one epistemological issue with your model. And this is to go back to Hayek's pretense of precision. Is a financial market a dead network or a living network? And if it is a living network in which the nodes are agents that are not rational and can change, can you measure that SRT, measure that risk to be SRT? That risk, in my view, is non-measurable. And it is a pretense of precision to measure it. And therefore, the model will give you a very interesting deterministic solution that you can calculate this, when in reality, it is much more correlation between the observer and the observed. I'm sorry to put this, but this is very fundamental to me, because what you are saying is actually 40 years of my work. I mean, I've been working on this, for the last 40 years, and it's either right or it's absolutely breakthrough, or it can be a very fundamental break.
So I think we must discuss more what is a living agent and what is not a living agent. I don't think I've understood that.
A living person, and how that person reacts, and how that crowd reacts, I am not sure you can measure.
Oh, good that you mentioned that. I'm showing a number, for example, this expected systemic loss. This is a number given that there's no intervention. That we have a systemic event, and then it unfolds as in a free and unregulated market. But the first thing, as once rumors occur that the bank is in bad shape, the first thing is for the government to step in and say, now, free markets are over, we're nationalizing this. We're taking tax money, we're bailing it out. We're not running the risk as politicians to watch a cascading event going on. So they're bailing it out from the beginning. They're not letting it unfold in the full way as this number is computed. We are seeing the worst effect given. Now we're seeing what is the amount of damage given there would be no intervention. Now you can make a plan. Now this number can help you to make a rational decision. Should I step in and take, if you take more money, tax money to bail a thing out that the systemic event would cause, you're doing a stupid thing.
This is a very important double-hander. The difference between a dead network and a living network is this. I'll give you a very simple example. Every bank regulator will tell you, there was a Spanish regulator when I was at the World Bank working on this problem, why do banks fail? And he said, if a bank tells you that a non-performing loan is 1, the auditor will tell you it is 2, the bank regulator will tell you it's 4, and when it's losses, the bank is not only completely bankrupt, it's infinite. That means the bank losses everything. Now, that's a living system, because the incentive of every agent is to cover up his losses. Okay? So here's the fundamental problem. Even if you give a super regulator who is completely objective in this, when the systemic risk failure increases, what does he do? Every regulator that I've come across in my life, including very advanced regulators, and that's why the crisis happened in front of them, pretend it does not exist. That means it is blowing up in their face, and because if it blows up, I have to deal with it. The politicians won't allow me to deal with it. I have to cover it up. And that's what I mean by a living network.
Okay. We're not talking about living networks.
Yeah, that's what I mean by living network.
No, but we're
you actually cover up the problem.
We're giving a rational benchmark.
That is the failure of the present models. It assumes that even the regulator is rational, but the regulator is not independent of the system. They've been captured. That's the heart of the political problem here.
Thank you. Professor Chibai?
No, but let me make one more.
Sure.
One more point. If we manage to shift, to make a regime shift from the present situation to a situation where we are in the mode or in the equilibrium of a systemic risk-free environment, then you have a completely different world created, a world where the danger of default is really reduced.
I accept your point. I'm just pointing out the...
No, I like your comment.
Stefan, I've just as very much of a total naive about economics, but I want to pick up a little bit on the last two comments. To what degree does the rate of interaction? So I have sort of two images in my mind. One is an energy surface, an equilibrium distribution of, or set of distribution of equilibria on a surface, which is the risk surface, if you will. And you could shift that equilibrium, which is what you just said, so that you come into a different stable equilibrium. But one of the questions that I don't really understand is what's the role of the rate at which those changes can occur? Because one of the things that seems to me that there is a presumption that it is a quasi-static, I mean, not static, but if the rate of transfer is fast enough, then it's not clear that the system actually adjusts. Am I missing,
No, you're not missing anything. I did not say something.
Okay.
Which I'm now going to say. Financial system is not generating rates of lending or something out of the blue. There's very often an economic cause for it, a demand for credit in the real economy, for example. And that determines the rate of how financial products are created and coming into being, and how credit comes into being and futures come into being. And that's driven from the real economy part. And so in the model, we are not putting a static network or something. We're letting the network of interbank lending evolve. And how do we do that? Through markets that are tailored in this agent-based model, tailored after how credit markets work. How a bank that has excess liquidity offers it. How, if you don't get that, you can approach a central bank and pay a higher price for credit, etc. So this is, we're not putting anything static. Every relation here is always on the move.
I understand that,
and the rates we are fixing by modeling this part as closely as possible to a given country situation. That determines the rates and the density of your matrices, of your interaction.
Including the possibility of speculation?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. How are people speculating? Firms are owned by people in households. Firms can be stock companies. They issue stock. Then people in households can buy these stock. The stock price can go up. There's a stock market in the simulator, and there are bubbles. So speculation is in there.
I think we have one more question, Professor.
Stefan, the problem is you're taking away the punch bowl from the bankers. If your tax were implemented, then there would be a tremendous change in the world financial system. Right? There would be everybody would. because the proportion of the tax depends upon the riskiness of the investment. All of a sudden, they're out of business. So what do you think are the political possibilities for the actual implementation of your method?
So we are talking with people from the, it's called DG Market. This is the European, DG is Directorate General. They're writing the legal text for banking supervision. We're talking to these people. We're talking to central bankers from Mexico, obviously, in England, in Germany. We're talking with the Ministry of Finance in Germany, with BaFin. In Germany, this is the Banking Supervision Board and the Austrian Central Bank. And the biggest thing might be that Canada just voted for a new banking supervision authority, which is now about to be implemented. And they have contacted us to implement these risk measures that they could monitor the systemic risk of individual transactions. If they implement this, doesn't matter if they implement the tax or not, but that they are interested enough to, this will cost something, no? To build up the hardware, etc., to monitor every transaction in a country, this costs something. And if we can be involved in this, it's a great honor for us.
I think it's a wonderful, optimistic moment in which we can finish this discussion. Let join me in thanking one more time, Professor Thurner. Let me give you the talk in the profession.